Okay, good morning, folks. I'm happy to say that everything worked in lab last night. We found a couple of broken displays. We found one. What time's your watch say?
12:19.
Sorry, a minute early. I found one development board that somebody had put a PIC 33 in instead of a PIC 32, and guess what? It didn't program. So you might want to check the development board for the correct chip when you get it. Some of them are new, some of them were used last year, but in any case, you want to check it. Everybody got to the point of having test code display on the TFT. I think everybody did. One group finished the lab. Any questions about lab one at this point? I tend to get more questions after the first lab because people start thinking about it, but they're probably not here today. Or some are. So any questions about lab one? Or about any aspect of this? One thing I forgot to mention is that there's a snippet of code embedded in the lab description which shows how to actually turn on the input, the comparator. And if you merely write a short program with this snippet of code in it, then you can test the comparator threshold value. However, before you connect any voltage source to the chip, you better make sure that that voltage source is inside the range 0 to 3.3 volts. Because like most CMOS, if you give it a voltage above 3 volts or below 0, it's very likely to destroy the input inverter. So you turn on the signal generator, you hook up the clip lead, signal generator happens to be set to 20 volts, you've just cooked your chip. So always check the polarity and the value of the input signal before you connect it. You could also, of course, put a 3 or 5 or a 1K resistor in series with the source to help protect the input pin, without affecting the accuracy at all, because since it's a CMOS gate, the input impedance is effectively infinity. It's probably 10 to the 8th ohms or so, 10 to the 9th ohms, and so a kilo ohm in series with that makes no difference at all. So are there any questions about the capture code that we talked about last time? There's a thread for displaying the period. There's a thread for calculating a 1 second time interval. It's approximately 1 second because, as a student pointed out, this yield time means that you're going to have at least 1,000 milliseconds between executions, but perhaps a little bit more. And then, of course, the meat of the matter is setting up all the peripherals, setting up the timer, the output captures, the output compares, the separate timer for doing the input capture, and then the input capture unit. Are there any questions on this? Straightforward? Yes.
Can I ask an unrelated question?
Always ask an unrelated question, sure.
Do you know what the C is like that the compiler works on? Is it, because the user guide suggests it's C89. Is it like a standards compliant C?
It is a ANSI standard compliant, I believe, C99 or 98. It's a standard GCC release. So it is absolutely standard GCC. Does that help?
Okay, yeah, because the user guide said something.
Well, yeah, but if you can find the compiler without the IDE and use it on the command line if you're that kind of person. Let me remind you, since somebody asked before class, that all of the lectures, this year's lectures, are at videonote.com, and last year's lectures are on YouTube. If you don't like what I said this year, look at last year's. What other questions?
I see here that you commented out the port B digital out. Why is that not needed? Does PPS do that already?
So I commented out the port B because a very common mistake that I have made for years is to forget to turn on or off an I/O pin. And so I obsessively do that. But then after setting it up, I realized that the PPS overrides the state of the pin. So if you specify PPS that you're going to hook OC2 to RPB5, then that completely overrides the I/O status of that pin. So you don't need it. That's why I commented it out. Yes, you don't need it.
But overrides it even if you set it as an input after you set it as a PPS output?
Yes, it absolutely turns off the multiplexer.
On that note, is there like an API for the PPS input and output? It wasn't on the payload.
There's exactly two macros. PPS output and PPS input, both of which I use here. And I couldn't find it in the API either. But the parameters are group number. How do you get the group number? You count blocks in the table. Is it the first block, the second block, third block, or fourth block? That's crude, folks. Why do I have to specify that? Why can't it figure that out? But never mind. You have to specify the block number by looking at the chart, at the table, and deciding which PPS block it's in. You give it a signal name and the signal name and the pin identifier. And there's only two functions, PPS out and PPS in. You can bypass that and set the registers directly. If you go to the I/O port reference manual as opposed to the API manual, if you go to the I/O port reference manual, it will tell you how to set up the PPS registers without using the PPS macros. But why bother? Unless you happen to think that way. There's a few I/O unit, I/O parameters, I/O units I've found that don't seem to have an API defined in PLIB. One is the charge time measurement unit, and the other are the pull up and pull down resistors on the I/O ports. So I wrote the entries for the pull up and pull down and thoughtfully put them into lab two, I think. And as for the CTMU, I think I ended up documenting that all on a separate page entitled Charge Time Measurement Unit. It's one of the links on the 4760 homepage. What else?
servers?
Yes.
So on the lab, it says to use the open capture instead of interrupts or bullying. Is it using the open capture
The capture is being read on the interrupt, but it's not capturing on the interrupt. It's capturing on the hardware event, which happens many cycles before the interrupt. So if you were to do it, if you were to do an interrupt and read the timer, you would get a different result than if you do the same interrupt and read the capture register. You might try that and see how different they are. I don't know how many cycles different they are. That would tell you how long it takes to get to the interrupt service routine. I would guess it's a few dozen cycles minimum. On AVR, it would be 70 cycles. On ARM, it would probably the non-vectored version, it was maybe 600 cycles. I don't know on this architecture. I haven't timed that yet, but it's probably a few dozen cycles. So, and if you just poll, you say, did the comparator change state? Did it change state? Did it change state? Is it high yet? Then you're going to be in some sort of while wait loop with an uncertainty of hundreds of cycles, probably. This is by far the most accurate way of getting an interval. What else? Well, let's look at some more code. We sort of beat this to death. Have you looked at this one yet, the TFT test code? This also uses PT Cornell 1.1, and the main thing I did here was to try and exercise the graphics commands that were available to the user. So what this is doing is to draw a bunch of stuff, but it's also, yeah, it's mostly drawing stuff, and it's ticking a clock, but I do that because I like to have stuff blink. Mostly what you're going to be using for this, for lab one, is to fill rectangles to erase text and then draw new text. You can make it yellow. This is a macro which defines yellow for the display. You can set the size. You can set the text size. You can erase to some other color besides black if you prefer to write in some other color. It's an open question. I don't know whether it is faster to erase text by writing it in black or to write a black rectangle over the text. Who'd like to make an argument one way or the other? I can make an argument both ways. Which do you think is faster? Writing a rectangle? Yes.
And does it have a sprite table for all
the characters? It has RAM lookup table. So it's not built into the display. That would be key, yeah. Right, because the lines are regular and they're all horizontal or all vertical, which means you don't have to do any slope calculation. You just draw blocks of pickles. If they're green. But that's the argument for using a rectangle, is that it's a very regular write. And there could well be a primitive on the display which draws a horizontal line. I don't know. The argument for, now make an argument for the text. Who wants to make an argument for why text is faster?
Fewer pixels.
Fewer pixels. probably 1/4 or 1/8 as many pixels. So if pixel drawing dominates, then text will be faster. I haven't, I mean, it doesn't seem worth testing, so I haven't tested it, but it's an interesting question. So that's just ticking the counter. Then I decided to see how good the color was. So every 2 seconds, this picks a random color, uses the rand function. I think rand function on GCC returns a short. I believe it returns a 16-bit, but I ended it with FFFF anyway just to make sure. And then masked this random number with the appropriate bits for red, green, and blue. And there's no sense to these numbers. You just have to know which bits of the 16 bits are used for each of the colors. Typically, if you have a small number of bits to use to specify a color, where color is now defined as red, green, blue vector, which of those three should have the most bits? In other words, I'm asking you a perceptual question. Where is your color sensitivity the greatest? Anybody know? What? Green.
Safety.
What?
Safety green.
Safety green? That's about right. Yeah, it's on the green. It's on the green-yellow boundary. Is about your best color discrimination. So that would say you should encode more bits as green, and which you have three color channels in your eye, right? Red, green, and blue. That's why CRTs have red, green, and blue. You have three color channels in your eye. Which of the three has the least resolution? Which do you see least accurately? Now let's say that you were evolved to live in a jungle where there was lots of fruit, and most of the fruit was red or yellow or green. Then probably you couldn't see blue very accurately. And in fact, your blue resolution is quite poor. So most limited bits, in this case 16-bit color, is going to encode more bits as red and green and less as blue, for some sort of match to your perceptual system. So this draws three color patches, and then it mixes them together and draws them as a RGB mix, because I wanted to see how good the colors were, and they're adequate. Then to check animation rate, I made a simple animation program which scans a circle, a disk actually, back and forth across the screen. And again, you're going to fill it, but before you calculate the new position, you're going to erase it, calculate the new position, fill the new one. And this is an easy animation. In fact, you can reasonably animate a few thousand small disks at animation rate. What's animation rate? How fast, how many frames per second do you need to see motion? 125 is you said 25? 25. 25 is what the old movie projectors run at. The old style movie projectors that actually like have film in them ran at 25. But they did a trick to turn the 25 into 50 by flickering it twice on each frame. So 50 is barely enough. I think a lot of you can see 50. Can any of you see flicker in these lights? No. These are flickering at 120. It's 2 times 60 hertz. Most people can't see that except at very low illumination. Saturday morning animation. You watch Saturday morning cartoons? No, of course you're not up on Saturday morning. But maybe when you are 12 years old, you watch Saturday morning cartoons, and that animation is 15 frames a second. It's being displayed at 30 frames a second, but the animation is being calculated at 15 frames a second. And I'd say anything above 15 gives you a sense of motion. So I chose a time of 32 milliseconds here, which is about 30 frames a second or so. Then of course we just set up the threads and turn on the display and then schedule the threads. Any questions about this at this point? If not, well then we'll start talking more about proto threads in detail. Yeah.
When you have the PT begin and PT end macros or whatever they are, after that happens, the code is indented by two spaces. Do you just like manually type in those two spaces to get that indent?
Good question. I don't remember what I did. Yes, probably. And I probably got that out of some demo version, but I don't know why I did it. If you don't like my indent protocol, you can make up your own. I am not picky about indentation, as some people I've heard are. But also, when you display stuff as a web page, the indentation gets all trashed, depending on exactly what characters you use. And this is all just web pages. Anything else? Okay, so let's talk a little bit about, more generally about protothreads. We've talked about a subset of it so far that allows you to define threads and execute threads, but not too much about thread communication, not very much about other utilities. For instance, the protothread supports a serial console that would run as a window on your laptop or PC and runs some terminal emulator, these days usually PuTTY, that allows you to type text back and forth to the CPU. To use this interface, you have to have a protocol adapter that takes the TTL level outputs from the 3-volt outputs from the microcontroller and converts them to standard RS-232 voltage levels, which are plus 5 and minus 12 volts. That's an old protocol. You could tell by the voltage. Had to be high voltage because it was running in a noisy electromechanical environment 100 years ago for teletypes, for mechanical teletypes. And so the plus 3 and 0 converted to plus 5 and minus 12 and inverted. If you plug into an RS-232 port, or we have protocol converters that take the 0 and plus 3 serial communication and convert them into a USB COM port, which is probably what you'll use. But if you've plugged in the USB COM port adapter to the PIC32, then you get to use the console functions, which allow you to use printf and scanf and all of the usual C input-output functions. The trick is in protothreads is to make them non-blocking. Because you have an idea when you write a program, you know how long it's going to take to do an output because you're counting the number of characters. And each character takes about a millisecond at 9600 baud. However, if you're waiting for human input, you can wait infinitely long. And so your multitasking program will die unless you can swap the task out while you're waiting for the oh-so-slow human. So I rewrote the put car and get car so that it was not blocking. So let's look at a little bit of example here. And this is a very artificial example. Thread 1 and thread 2 bounce a semaphore back and forth. So they alternately execute and wait for the other thread to execute. Thread 3's command line. Thread 4 toggles an I.O. pin when spawned by thread 3. Thread 6 toggles an I.O. pin when signaled by thread 3. So a signal is different than a spawn. And there's some LEDs hooked up, and pin 25 is used for the voltage reference output. Oh, so this actually turns on the VREF output, so you can measure it at the output on a port pin. And I'm assuming that the serial connections are connected to pins 21 and 22. In config.h, we have to make sure that the serial lines are turned on. There's a whole bunch of structs here that are used to control six different threads plus some threads that are required for the serial output. And all the thread one is going to do is to, well, first of all, it's going to wait on a semaphore. We're going to define a semaphore later on. It's going to wait on a semaphore that somebody has to signal, otherwise the thread hangs there forever. It's not blocking. It's a non-blocking wait. Another thread can execute, but this thread will stop until the semaphore is signaled. After it's signaled, the first thing that happens is that a value 3 pulse is put out for 2 microseconds on the debug pin. So if you were just watching the debug pin, then you'd know that thread 1 is executing. So this is a thread debugger. We're going to toggle an I.O. pin, which will blink an LED. Then we're going to signal the control structure, the semaphore, for task 2, and then yield for some time or another, and then go back and do it again. So we're going to yield, we're going to wait for a while, then we're going to go back and wait for the semaphore. Meanwhile, task 2 is going to do almost the same thing. It's going to wait for this control structure for the semaphore, control underscore T2. It's going to put a value of 6 on the debug pin for 5 microseconds. It's going to toggle another pin. It's going to signal task 1 or thread 1. So thread 1 signals thread 2. Thread 2 signals thread 1. That means you could have deadlock. You have to worry about that. This tells thread 1 to go, and then it hops back and waits with no delay. Just hops back and waits for task 1. So task 1 is going to be throttling the rate of the blink. And the semaphores are going to be doing the communication between the two threads. Now, let's skip down to the thread 3, which is the user interface. And you're going to be using this, you're going to be using the interface a lot in lab 4, but you might use it before then for debugging, for instance. And what we're going to do is to do a send buffer. We're going to send a string to the buffer, to the output buffer, and then we're going to spawn a new thread from inside this thread. we're going to spawn a thread called DMA output, which is going to use the direct memory access unit to grab an array from memory and spit it out of the serial port in one large chunk from the CPU's point of view. It starts the transfer, then it says, then it blocks the thread from executing until the DMA burst is done, but does not keep any other thread from executing. The alternative would have been to send one character, load a buffer for one character, take a context switch, go do something else, come back, send another character, take a context switch, go do something else. This takes one context switch. You start the DMA burst, you go do something else for a while. When the DMA is done, this thread starts to execute again from after the spawn. So the spawn is blocking for this thread. A spawn blocks this thread, but doesn't block any other thread. Then we spawn an input process called PT input, which is going to load a serial buffer. And this one does, they take a context switch after every character that this very slow human types, because there's usually a dozen or two dozen milliseconds between each keystroke, and you don't want to block during that. So you'd record the keystroke in an array, take a context switch, go off and do something else, execute another thread. Another keystroke occurs, you come back, handle it, go off and do another thread. So again, the thread halts here until some event happens and Pete and the spawn returns, and the event that returns is when the human types enter. Then this returns. And then we do an scanf to find out what's actually in the term buffer and evaluate it in this case into a command and an integer. So this is a little this is a really boring little command interpreter, but what it does is to check for a T, a B, an S, a W, or a P. T says it sets the blink time for threads 4 and 6, and then B spawns thread 4, which blinks an LED once and then returns. While this process is spawned, this thread is locked, as opposed to case S, which signals and produces a pulse of the same length from another thread. But while this thread is producing the pulse, this thread is not locked, because a spawn locks this thread, but a signal is just a command that another thread is ready to run and does not block this thread. So the both thread 4 and 6 have the same effect externally. They both blink an LED, but one of them is blocking and the other is non-blocking for this thread. They're never blocking for another thread. And then wait blocks this thread for 2 seconds. Why did I do this weird stuff? Because I was trying to make sure that only one thread was blocked. I wanted to debug the threader, and so I had to slow everything down enough that I could perceive when the lights were blinking to make sure that the events that were supposed to happen at a given time happened, even if a given thread was blocked. Make sense? Yeah. Oops. Got too aggressive with my zoom. So now we go back up and look at thread four, and thread four is a fairly simple little thing that just sets the debug value for 10 microseconds, makes a pulse of length wait 2, turns it on, turns it off, and then exits. And that doesn't just end, it exits, because it is a spawned thread, and when you hit the exit, the spawn dies and you go back to the original thread. So this is killing the thread. The end marks is kind of like the lexical end of the text that is the thread, but this is an actual exit. Whereas thread 6 is waiting on a semaphore. It waits on a semaphore. When the semaphore is released by the command thread, by thread 3, it again sets a port pin, waits for the, it does a yield for the wait time, the length of the pulse, and then clears the bits, but does not lock the command thread. So we set all this mess up. We make a bunch of pins outputs. This gives the syntax for multiple bits being set as outputs, and you can just OR bit names together and they all become outputs. We init the control structures. So here we're going to do a semaphore init, and it better be the case that either semaphore control for thread 1 or thread 2 is valid. Because if they're both 0, it's deadlocked and neither will ever execute. So you set one semaphore, initialize one semaphore to 1 and the other one to 0. And now when these start to execute, when you actually start the scheduler, the semaphore controlling thread 2 is set to 1, it executes, it sets the thread, it sets the control for timer for task 1, for thread 1, and then thread 1 can execute. So this hopefully avoids the deadlock. And we knit the threads, then we do a round robin schedule. Any questions about this? I wanted to see how contorted I could make the command structure for a set of threads and still have it execute. The fact is, it works rather well. Part of the reason for doing this was, if you go back and look at this, this is in version 1.2, and this code did not work in version 1.1. because there was a bug that did not allow a yield inside of a case statement. Oh my God. So I had to check all of these conditions, spawn, signal, and yield, inside of the case statement to make sure I got it right. That's why it's a little bit contorted. Oh, I think it's a pretty good demo because it talks a lot about communication and signaling and semaphores, the difference between a semaphore signal and a spawn. So I left it. What's hidden here through behind this whole thing is that PT threads is just a bunch of C macros. And so your code is actually running as one continuous thread of control using a documented C feature called Duff's device. You ever heard of it? Probably not. It is a very weird feature in C which says that it is legal to enter a while loop from outside the loop anytime you want. Oh my God. you can jump into a while loop and it behaves correctly. You look sick. Yeah, this is disturbing. And that's what this whole system is doing, is allowing you to more or less transparently, to your way of thinking, thread between different while loops by means of yields and signals. It's all one thread of control. There's one stack. There is no explicit context switching except where you happen to be inside this extraordinarily contorted piece of code. But you don't see that. All you see is threads. But if you want to expose that level, you can go look at the header file, Cornel 1-2, and this has the header from Adam Duckles on it for obvious legal reasons. These are his implementations of what are called local continuations, which is the underlying technology. Then some defines on which set up the internals of the threader, and some initialization stuff. And this is really out in the weeds, folks. But finally, we get to something that's slightly recognizable, PT wait and tell. You do some sort of weird operation on LC set and return some condition and do something. But you don't need to know this. What you might be interested in, but you might be interested in it, you know, because it's after all running on there. And you might want to hack it. If you come up with something interesting, let me know and I'll include it. But somewhere down here, I added a bunch of stuff. And what I added is probably worthwhile thinking about a little bit. I added a macro to yield for a certain amount of time. And the reason I bring this up is that it uses a resource on the chip. It uses timer 5. So if you mess with timer 5, you will trash protothreads. I wrote a rate scheduler, which allows you to say to give a rate priority to different tasks, so that you can cause a write to go 2, 4, 8, or I think 16 times at a higher rate than other tasks. I don't think you're going to need to use that, but you might. Wrote a macro to make the VREF into a 4-bit DAC to use for output. And then some utilities to set up the UART. And this is really in the weeds, because this is now using yields to avoid all blocking behavior in the UART, which would normally wait for fractions of a millisecond per character, and you don't want to do that. But if you don't like the behavior, hack on it. But document it for the poor TA. But probably the most amusing one is the DMA send. Gonna yield until UART transmit ready. That's to say, make sure that nothing else is being transmitted right now. And oh, by the way, you have to protect this with a semaphore, because there's only one UART, and if two threads try and send stuff through the same UART, something bad is going to happen. So you send a byte, just one byte, which is guaranteed not to block because you waited until the UART was ready. You start the DMA transfer by turning on the channel. You enable the channel, and then you just wait until the DMA is done. and magic has happened, and the whole array, all of the characters, has been sent. So between here and here could take large fraction of a second, but there's no commands being executed on the CPU to support that. It's all going through the side channel, which is a direct memory access coprocessor. Then you just kill this thread to allow the calling thread to start executing again. Then there's this big PT setup, and you probably do want to look at this because PT setup does a lot of stuff, and it starts configuring IO pins and playing with DMA and setting up timer 5. And if you don't want that to happen, you have to change this code. But you'll notice that a lot of it is protected by an ifdef. So if you don't want to use the vref for debug, you just undefine use vref debug, and then all of the code that modifies pin 25 will be turned off. And in fact, that's in config.h. So if you go to config.h, you'll find that there's a define use vref debug. If you comment this, then pin 25 will be useful for whatever you want to use it for, like for instance the TFT that you're using in lab 1 uses pin 25. If you uncomment use UART serial, then you gain back pins 21 and 22, which are the UART interface. And the config.h that you were given in the zip file for lab 1 has these commented, and so you don't have to worry about it for this lab. But you should be aware that you may have to modify it for a given configuration anytime. You always, for every project you set up, you need to go to config.h and say, is this reasonable? It's not automatic. And then we set up the clock parameters. We set the sys clock to 440 million, and we set the PB clock to sys clock because we're dividing by 1. But you can change that. You can change that right here up in the, I pointed at that screen, you can't see it. You can change it right up here. You can change the phase lock loop dividers or the phase lock loop multipliers to whatever frequency you want. But then you better change sys frequency and PB frequency down here in the sys clock and PB clock down here in config.h also. So main point here is config.h is not something you set and forget. You change it every time you start a new project, or you may change it every time you start a new project. So, any questions? So what I'll probably do then is to let you think about this overnight and then come back to something like the same slide again next time and ask if there's any questions. Any questions? Yes? You're pointing to something, so. Yeah.
No, I just noticed, because we talked yesterday about the PB clock frequency.
Mm-hmm. Right, there it is, right? That's why you always look at this file. Yeah. Okay, thanks.